You're not going to be any trouble, are you?
You'll be okay.
Thank you for being so cooperative and everything. We appreciate it. Makes everything a lot easier.
I'm gonna baby girl to get one piece so that it's quick. We can get this out of the quicker. I can get back to
you. Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. So we kind of introduced ourselves already, but I'm gonna show you our IDs. You know who we are. Kevin Strauss. And I'm Adam Kramenbauer. And we're both with the FBI. So I know that the folks, the officers over there, gave you an advice of rights, but we need to do everything. So before we talk to you, I'm just gonna read this to you. And same thing, execute forms. We're gonna have several forms tonight. So we are at Forest Grove, right?
Correct.
It is February 11th.
If you don't mind me asking, why me though? Because I mean, I was so low on the totem pole, like I was just a medic.
We're gonna explain everything to you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know you got a lot of questions, and that's the point of this. We'll have a conversation and explain to you what's going on.
Yes, sir. We have for time. I have 7:58 p.m. Just so you know, and this is just because we're in a police station, this room is recorded, just to let you know. So it's 7:58 p.m. Before we ask you any questions, you must understand your rights. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can be used against you in court. You have the right to talk to a lawyer for advice before we ask any questions. You have the right to have a lawyer with you during questioning. Cannot afford a lawyer, one will be appointed for you before questioning if you wish. And if you decide to answer the questions without a lawyer present, you have the right to stop answering at any time. This statement says, I have read this statement of my rights and I understand what my rights are. At this time, I'm willing to answer questions without a lawyer present. So we ask that you would initial each statement and then you sign and then we sign here.
Okay.
So we did guys choose FBI to get this.
So just real quick though, but we just want to make sure you understand each statement. If you could just initial next to each that's just part of our administrative requirement. You're in the Army, you know how it goes.
Yeah, print sign date all the time.
Appreciate it.
Not a problem.
Where'd you go to school?
What's that?
Did you go to school? Where'd you go to, did you graduate from?
Graduated from Tongue Point, actually, the Job Corps out there, because I wasn't really doing very well in school. And
really?
I was like my lifelong dream to be in the Army.
Okay.
So actually, because when I joined the Army, I had full intentions of getting out and becoming like a police officer and all that kind of stuff. And then I realized that being a police officer would need a lot of schooling and that kind of stuff, and I couldn't afford it, so I was like, all right, might as well do security, it's the next best thing.
Yeah.
So I took up security, and I've been doing it ever since.
Well, it's cool, man. Yeah, you come from Forest Grove.
Negative. I'm from originally from Gaston.
Gaston, okay.
Yeah.
How far is Gaston from here?
Probably like 10 miles.
Maybe. Yeah.
About that. I think it's that way. Oh, it's all that way.
Away from Beaverton or
that way.
Okay.
Yeah, it's down Highway 47 towards like Yamhill. You guys probably aren't from around here, are you?
I am not actually.
Yeah.
I'm from California, so
Oh, wow. I'm not that important, am I?
No, I moved here from California a little bit.
Okay, I was about to say, oh my God, people come from California to get me? Like, this is, I was just a medic, man.
We ask this because anybody signs these. What's your highest level of education?
High school diploma, and also I've got a plastering certificate from Job Corps. So I guess I get
Technical?
Yeah, technical, okay. I guess, if you want to call it.
Okay. And then you can read and understand English, correct?
Yes,
sir. Read, write, and understand?
Yes, sir.
All right. Then that's good. So basically, obviously you know what happened down at the refuge, mm-hmm. and everything. You were down there, correct?
Yes, sir.
So this is purely what this is about. We're going to ask you questions about what happened there, how long you were there, who was down there, you know, just simple questions like that. And part of this is to figure out, like, who some of the decision makers were, who was giving orders and things like that. We're just trying to get a better handle on what happened out at the refuge.
And listen, we're not here to debate, you know, where you stand, where we stand, whose land that belongs to, federal government, overreach, people's wealth. We're not here to argue, okay? I mean, we're just here
I'm
to
not
just...
I'm not here to argue. I want to get back to my time.
No problem, man. I hear you. I just want to, you know, I don't... We're just here to, you know, get to the bottom of some things, show you some photos, and ask you some questions, and we'll be on our way, okay?
So. Absolutely, sir.
One other thing, because I don't have your phone with me right now. Do you know what kind of phone it is?
Yeah, it's an iPhone 5S.
iPhone 5S?
Yep.
So would you mind executing a consent to search for that as well? The 5S phone?
I guess so,
yeah. It's just to see, you know, like if there was any calls made or anything like that.
I didn't have service down there.
Okay.
I mean, you guys, by all means, if it gets me out of here sooner, I don't care what you guys do.
Okay.
We appreciate your cooperation. Yeah. I really do.
I mean, it's up to you. So, I mean, it would help move this along, and that's what our interest is.
I mean, if it gets me home sooner, then I really don't care.
Okay, so you said it's iPhone?
5S. It's iPhone 5.
iPhone 5S. What color is it?
White. Gold. It's the white and cherry gold or something like that.
White.
How long ago did you get it? Did you get it at the store or at an outlet or something?
I got it at the Cricket store.
Yeah.
What's the telephone number?
971.
Hold on.
And so,
971.
720.
720.
4167.
4167. So iPhone 5S, white and gold in color, telephone number 971-720-4176, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
That says 4167. Did you say 4176?
4167.
67, okay.
Okay. All right.
Is there any chance I could be able to go home tonight to my family, or am I kind of screwed?
Probably not. Probably not. What we'll end up doing is... We're going to let you see your daughter, okay?
I really appreciate that, guys.
Yeah, so they're gonna come down to the station. So basically what's going to happen, we're going to talk briefly about what went on. We'll talk about what the actual charge is. We're going to take you downtown. They're just going to...
Like Portland?
Yeah.
Oh, geez.
Well...
Is your car ride going to be more comfortable than that thing was?
Yes, yes, for sure.
Okay.
And then they'll process you, and then we'll have a court date or tomorrow morning. So that's pretty much the quick and dirty of it. But we will go into more of that during our conversation. So like we did last time, just initial each one of these statements. So it's, I have been asked by special agents of the FBI to permit a complete search of iPhone 5S, white and gold in color, telephone number, and contents. I've been advised of my right to refuse consent. I give this permission voluntarily. I authorize these agents to take any items which they determine may be related to their investigation.
Yeah, if you guys aren't snooping through like pictures or anything, because I've kind of got a few inappropriate pictures, I'm not going to lie.
Confidential, private, that doesn't get released. That's private, confidential stuff. If we see it, we don't release that information. So
okay.
You have my word on that.
Okay. Yeah, I appreciate that.
No problem.
Because I just got a few pictures on there that my fiance, if she found out that anybody else saw, she'd kill me. Like, I'm not saying she was actually going to kill me. I'm just
so, Jeff, so initial by 1, 2, 3, 4, that you read those.
And just for the administrative purpose, what is the unlock code on your phone?
0419. It's my daughter's birthday.
Can you write that here? Just say unlock code.
Appreciate it.
No problem.
Makes things a little easier, but
do not mind. And then
just initial it. Yeah.
My thumbprint is also another unlock.
Okay. And initial that. Initial number 4. Initial this line that there's nothing else. And then print your name, please.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so we did a consent to search. So I just wanted to, so that we know all that has happened tonight. So we did a consent to search of your vehicle, which you were on scene for.
I feel really bad about you guys finding my little C4 thing for airsoft, because I saw the look on his face when it brought up. He was like, what the f*** is this? I'm like,
that's all right. So we did that consent to search. We took a look. We'll talk about what items of our of interest. I mean, okay. We addressed some with you. We did the consent to search for your iPhone. Mm-hmm. So thank you. We did your advice of rights. You read and understand your rights. And this will be the receipt for property that is of interest when we finish this up.
Okay.
And then, so now we're just, so what, when did you go down to the refuge?
I don't honestly remember the exact date. I want to say it was like the 7th.
Okay. 7th of?
January.
Okay. And what was your purpose for going down there?
Medical support, just a warm body, just kind of make a presence, just to kind of let everybody know that, hey, like, I don't exactly know exactly what's going on, but I mean, like, if you guys need medical attention, I'm here. So, because I mean, I saw on pictures that there was a 200-foot tower. I was like, God forbid somebody fall off that thing and get hurt.
Right. Okay.
So I was down there just to kind of be like, all right, I've got all my medical stuff here for you guys. Just let me know what you guys need.
Okay. Were there any other medics there too, or just?
There was one other.
Okay.
How did you? Who invited you? Who brought you? Who told you to come down?
It wasn't really an invitation.
Okay.
It was kind of like my Oregon 3% group.
Mm-hmm.
I've just kind of been. They post stuff on Facebook all the time of like what's current events, basically.
Right.
And I chose that one because I was like, oh my god, this is like really close to home. I don't know exactly what's going on. So, like I said, I kind of chose them out.
So based on the 3% postings, the Oregon 3%, that's how you became aware, and then you decided to go and assist.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you got there January 7th. When did you leave?
25th. I don't know. It was right after they said that if you leave now, you'll be free to go.
Okay.
So I was like, okay, that nope.
Through the checkpoints.
Okay. Well, not like through the checkpoints. There was no checkpoints.
Right. Okay.
But they said if you are willing to go, if you want to go now, and this is your free pass, blah blah. And me being like I am now, like you guys see me, I'm almost like I've got a daughter, I've got a fiance, I've got too much stuff to do.
Right.
So I was like, okay, later, guys. I'm sorry. They were like, put through with the fence. So I mean, I was just like.
Yeah. Okay. So, when you got word that free to go, no rest, you headed out.
Yep.
Okay. Where did you go from the refuge?
I went straight home.
Okay.
Straight home. Just because I wanted to see my baby. It was eating me alive being gone that long.
And where was home? Or where is home? Yeah, where did you go?
I went straight to my friend Tiffany's house.
Okay. So where you were staying tonight?
Yeah.
Okay. And what's that address?
2137 Willamina Avenue. Forest Grove, Oregon, 97116.
So you were staying there. Do you have a room there?
Negative. I've been just kind of, they have a hide a bed.
Okay.
I'm sleeping on the hide a bed with my fiance and baby girl, because, I don't know, I honestly, I had a feeling that I was being watched, and I was like, well, if this is, like, this is kind of.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
Okay. What gear did you bring down to the refuge? When you said you had your medical stuff and all that.
I brought a play carrier. I brought a, because I mean, God forbid, like I didn't want to be like that one person there, not, you know, I didn't want to be there like all of a sudden an ambush happened and I was just like, ah!
You don't have any
protective
armor.
Okay. Yeah. So you have plates?
Yes, I do.
What level?
Level 3.
Yes. Okay.
That's just steel plates.
Steel plates?
Yeah.
Okay.
Level
3 or level 4?
I think they're level 3.
Okay.
I mean, there's.
They'll stop a rifle round, correct?
I believe so. I hope so. That's what they told me when I bought them.
How much were they when you got them?
I bought them for $250.
$250?
Yep.
Cheaper than dirt? or the pair?
The pair.
Okay. Online or
cheaper than dirt.
Yeah.
It's amazing site. I brought a AR-15, which I don't remember who it was that I told. I mean, I was just scared at the time. I'm not going to lie to you when I said this, because I mean, I'll straight up tell you, I lied a little bit because I was really afraid, because like, this is the first time I've ever even seen an FBI agent.
Okay, that's
okay. Two of them in the same room. But I left my rifle there just because I
at the refuge?
Yes, I didn't want anything to do with it. I was just like, I don't want anything to do with it. I'm gone. I left my clothes there. I left everything there.
Okay.
So I was just like.
So basically, you're saying, like in the car when I asked you and you said, oh, it might be stolen. That was a lie.
Yeah, it was. I'm not going to lie to you. Yes,
okay.
It was.
I appreciate you being honest.
Thank you very much.
And it makes this so much easier. So you left your rifle.
I left my rifle there just because I didn't want to get caught with it on the drive home and be like, okay, sir, well, come with me.
Understood. That's cool.
You know, so did you leave it there, or did you leave it in the custody of someone, say you could use this?
No. Okay. Hell no. I left it in my room. I was like, I left all my stuff in my room right there. I was just like, no.
Okay.
I, however, did take my plate carrier just because, like, that's kind of my baby. And
sure. Okay.
That's, like, one of those things, like, if somebody broke into my house, I'm not going to be facing them with this.
Yeah. Right. What room, like you said, your room?
Room 2.
Stayed in room 2.
Like, if you go, I don't know if you ever, like, been referenced to the bunkhouse. You go to the bunkhouse, it's the room all the way down on the right. All the way down.
Okay. All the way down.
All the way down on the right side.
How were the conditions there when you stayed there? We, neither of us have been on the refuge, right?
They were pretty good.
Pretty good conditions.
Yeah.
I mean, plenty of supplies, you know.
Actually, once you guys go through the phone during the search, you'll see there's a picture of, like, it's just packed from floor to ceiling, wall to wall, full of food,
okay.
Firewood, and blankets, clothes.
Okay. So, your equipment, you brought your plate carrier that'll stop rifle rounds, steel plates, 250 a pair.
Mm-hmm.
You brought your AR-15.
Yep.
Did you bring ammunition?
Negative. I did not, actually. I had to get ammo from other people. But, I mean, don't get me wrong. I had no intentions of using it on, like, Americans. I was just down there just kind of, you know, supporting the Second Amendment.
Okay. So, did you bring magazines?
Yes.
How many magazines?
Four.
Four magazines? What capacity?
Five.
All right.
Five.
Five magazines?
What capacity?
30
rounds.
30 rounds? So
29 rounds if you want to be technical about it, because you don't want to freaking out.
You don't want to overload them. Yeah. So, five 30-round magazines.
Yeah.
You only load them up to 29 because you want your gun to function. and you said you got ammunition when you got down there.
Yes, I did.
Do you know who gave you ammunition? Or?
Lord, save me. I know this is going to be bad if they hear this. I don't care because I want to go home. His name's Scotty.
Scotty?
Scotty. We call him Scotty, cameraman.
Scotty, cameraman.
Like, are they going to hear this in court? Like the guys that are on trial too.
If this goes to trial for you, right? I mean, they're not going to be in the courtroom. So, I mean, we don't even as good a cameraman is. Like, okay. I've never heard that.
Put it this way. A recorded interview. So do you know how court usually works? So like if you go to court, this recorded interview is not going to be played at your own trial. Like if you're making these statements, right? Mm-hmm. If we need you to testify, we're going to ask you yourself to testify to what you said. Or they will ask me to tell the court what you said. You know, that's kind of how it works. So you typically wouldn't, recorded interviews of someone wouldn't be played for other defendants.
Okay, I was about to say, I just don't want them hearing me and being like, oh, that guy's, and then when I get out, them being trying to find me and being like,
I mean, I can't. I have no intention of playing your recorded interview to anybody else involved, any of these other defendants in the takeover.
Okay.
If that helps. So.
That's honor.
I would not. Yeah.
In the federal system, you know, the two ways you help yourself are you tell the truth and you cooperate. Okay. And it sounds like you're doing all that right now. So that's how you help yourself. You know, when it comes down later to if this goes to trial, or if you know you'll get an attorney, or if you already have an attorney, whichever, right? So you'll discuss those things with your attorney, and if it goes before a judge or a jury, etc. Your cooperation and your honesty go a long way. Okay, I mean, both of us would go in front of the court and say this man was honest. He told the truth. He was trying to help us out, and we will testify to that. So.
I really respect that. Message.
Yeah. And the other thing, Jeffrey, like if down the road, like let's say we have this honest conversation and either, you know, the only other time that it could be used too is like if down the road that you lied here, then that could be used to refute your lie. Like, hey, well, you said this on, you know, you said this, and then on this date you're saying something else.
Yeah.
Or vice versa. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So as long as you're consistent, then my testimony is just as good as a recorded statement from you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Scotty Cameraman. So is his name Scotty? Or?
Yeah, his name's Scotty. He's from Texas, I think.
Okay. But why is he a cameraman?
I just always want a camera.
He's the one, if you look on YouTube, the guy that took down the camera.
Oh, I gotcha. Okay.
He's the guy that took down the camera.
What?
Oh, the
that's what we call cameraman.
So okay. The camera's okay. I gotcha.
Okay.
I wasn't a part of that, just so you
okay.
know.
Okay. Okay.
Guy who took down cameras. Okay, so he gave you 5 magazines worth of ammunition? Or?
Yep.
Okay. What kind of ammunition?
It was... are you talking about like what, like rounds or what? What's
yeah, what kind caliber? What caliber? What kind?
5.56. I don't know. They're all the same to me.
5.56. Did they have any color tip on them?
Red.
Red.
Red and green.
Red and green tipped. Okay.
Yeah. I think one of them felt almost like plastic.
Okay. So you brought your plate carrier AR-15. 5 magazines. You got 5.56 ammunition from Scotty, the cameraman from Texas.
Mm-hmm.
But red and green tipped ammunition or something like that.
One tip felt like it was plastic.
Okay. And anything else you brought down?
I brought down my bug out gear, like extra clothes and cooking utensils, because I thought I was going to be staying in a tent. I brought down a tent, a sleeping bag. It's just a lot of stuff I can't really name off at this moment.
Survival gear.
Yeah, basically.
Camping gear. Just gear to take care of yourself.
Pretty much, yeah.
You said earlier you brought medical gear.
Yes.
What type of medical gear?
Tourniquets. SAM splints. I brought quick clots. I brought tampons because, you know, pretty useful.
Okay.
it's kind of weird for a man to say about tampons.
Now, just For everyone's edification, we know what you're talking about, but you're talking not for females, but to plug bullet holes,
yeah.
correct? Because
yeah.
tampons are effective.
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
Yes.
Okay.
I brought some, basically like an entire first aid kit that had like cough drops, like little band-aids, regular, like your normal first
yeah.
aid kit. But
first aid kit, okay.
Yeah.
Now, you brought all that stuff for what purpose?
Just to be of help, like I said earlier, like if somebody fell off the tower, I want to be able to put a tourniquet on them just in case if like they had a compound break and then it went through an artery, I'd just like a tourniquet and get them.
But then like the quick clot and the tampons and stuff, I mean, obviously that's typically used to treat gunshots. I mean, were
yeah.
you expecting that maybe there would be some kind of altercation?
I was, but however, like, that's kind of where I was like, said earlier, like if something did happen, I was going to do nothing but put down my rifle and run to everybody else's aid. Like you would have seen some crazy ass person out there running around without a rifle being like, hey, you'll be all
right,
you'll be all
right.
Right,
right.
Did you think that, you know, if folks at the refuge were going to, engage law enforcement or...
Like if they did, you would have seen somebody just laying there, full spread eagle, like.
No, not you. I'm just talking about other people. Like, how did you expect the people to act? Did you think that they were gonna engage law enforcement?
Nobody really had the intentions of engaging. It was more like one of those things. Like, if they showed up, guns blazing, then they would return fire. But I'm like, I'm here to support. Like, this isn't for use. Like, I'm here to shoot some barrels and just carry it around and support my Second Amendment. I'm not gonna shoot or nothing.
Okay.
And they're like, well, what if they were going to shoot you? And I was like, they wouldn't shoot me because I did come in here and I'd drop all kit. I'd be like, sorry, I'm just trying to do my Second Amendment.
Okay.
But.
All right, so you brought a plate carrier,
mm-hmm.
rifle, 5 mags. You were given ammunition. You brought all your medical gear. Anything else?
Did you come by yourself? Sorry, I missed that. Did you come with anyone else?
Yes, actually, I did. I came with a guy named Tom Wagner and Jeremy Evan Smith.
Okay.
I think I know who Jeremy is. Yeah.
So you part of the Oregon 3%, or is there an Oregon 3%?
Yes,
okay.
It's not like a real 3%. It's more of like a Facebook group that
okay.
people kind of join for Oregon that are... wanting to better the cause, pretty much.
Sure. Okay. So, when you're out there, did you recognize people from Facebook that were out there too, or you know,
the only
person
I recognized was John Ritzheimer and Ammon Bundy.
Okay.
That's about it.
Okay. If you mind, we can go into that. I that's something I'm pretty curious about. Like, you read a lot. I've read a lot. I've seen a lot on the media, on TV, etc. But I don't know if that's just part of what we're seeing. You know, we don't see the whole person, and because you're actually out there, could you tell us a little bit more about some of the people, you know, of interest? You know, like this sort of the top, like the Bundy brothers,
mm-hmm.
Ammon and Ryan. Can you tell us about them at all?
They were really, really religious. Like they personally, I remember actually talking to them, and like it was like a quick like 10-minute conversation.
Yeah.
It was about a conversation about God, and they're really religious.
Yeah.
And they even agreed with me. I was like, so if the feds actually came in here, honestly, Ammon, would you shoot him? And he's like, probably not. That's not what I'm here for. I want peace. I want equality. And I was like, all right. So that's where I got my whole, I'm going to put my rifle down.
Right.
So.
Okay. What about Ryan? Did you talk to them together or separate?
Yeah, I mean Ryan, he was also really like a go-getter kind of person. Like he was a, not like a go-getter person, but like a,
yeah, yeah.
I don't know how to explain it honestly. He was like a
active, intense, driven.
Yeah, really like a confident, driven,
goal-oriented,
mm-hmm.
motivated.
Like, he really believed in the Constitution. I mean, like, same with, like, I do, obviously.
Right.
Like, and hopefully all Americans believe in it, but, he really believed in it, and he was trying to get everybody to follow it, like, word for word. But that was the problem. all that really knew about him.
Okay.
With Ammon and Ryan, whether or not, did you ever see them armed?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
So you never saw Ryan with a rifle or a pistol?
I'm trying to remember. Because I mean, I only saw Ryan and Hammond probably like five times the entire time. I don't think I've ever seen Ryan with a gun.
Okay. And Hammond, did you ever see him with a gun?
No.
Okay.
What about meetings? Did they have meetings out there?
Mm-hmm. You know, absolutely, all the time. The press conference was at on Monday at 11 o'clock.
So you all, everyone there attended the press conference?
Yes.
Okay. What about like non-press conference meetings, you know, getting everyone together, talking about things that are going on in the refuge, goals, rules of engagement, if you will, anything like that?
Yeah, like everybody kind of really knew what the rules of engagement were. So, I mean, there was nobody really in charge of rules of engagement, if you will. But for like the most part, people that were mostly talking, I mean, they're already in custody. I mean, there's Ryan Payne and John Ritzheimer.
Okay. You're saying, like, they're chain of command kind of thing? Like, those are
No, I mean, it's not like chain of command, because, I mean, like, everybody put in their piece. Right. The meetings, okay. Everybody
sure.
put in their piece.
Everyone added to the meetings.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I mean, it wasn't just, like, two people being like, I'm in charge, you're going to listen to me. You know, it was like, all right, so this is what's going on, blah, blah, and then what do you guys think? And then that's when everybody else was.
I see, okay. Was there ever a time when, you know, maybe one person had a certain direction they thought it should go, and then someone else put in their two cents
mm-hmm.
and said,
that's
hey,
exactly
you know what,
the meetings
let's,
were.
Let's think about this another way, and then the direction changed a little bit, you know, something like that?
That's kind of the way the meetings went, like, say, like, I'd be like, all right, this is what's going on, blah, blah, and then you would say, I think we should do this, and then you would say, no, I think we should do this, and I'd be like, no, I kind of agree with both of you, so this is kind of the common ground, and then there would be somebody else that butts in and be like, I think you're all stupid, blah.
Really? Were there disagreements, were there fights ever?
No, everybody did.
Everyone got along.
Close, yeah.
I mean, was there some kind of, you're saying there's no real structure, you know, but I mean, was it kind of understood certain people were looked up to, you know? Or
yeah, I guess you could say that, like Ryan and Ammon.
Okay.
Ryan Payne, I mean, Bundy and Ammon.
Can you talk about Ryan Payne a little bit? You know, he was one of the first people arrested, you know?
I honestly didn't really get the... I hate to say it because I'm in custody, but I mean, I didn't really get the honor to meet the guy.
Okay.
Just because, like, it was, like, one of those things, like, hey, Ryan, how you doing? He's like, hey, Jeff, how you doing?
Okay. Like, so, friendly in passing, but you never
pretty
had a chance
yeah.
to, okay.
Let's talk about, like, security of the refuge. How did, were there patrols set up?
Mm-hmm.
Or, like, how was it secured?
There was two men in the tower.
Two men in the tower.
Mm-hmm. The shifts kind of flip-flopped. There would be, like, four-hour shifts. There'd be eight-hour shifts. I mean, when I first got there, there was a dude up there for 25 hours.
Wow.
Yeah, so, I mean...
Pretty intense.
Yeah.
You remember who that was? Do you remember who was up in the tower where there's... Were there assigned people to only be in the tower, or did it just...
No, it was a cycle, like, now it's my turn to be in the tower,
okay.
next time, it's kind of...
Would you guys use scopes, or, you know, binoculars, or...
We did use, like, night vision and that kind of stuff in the tower, just to, like, I think I'm kind of weird for it, but I used them, honestly, just to kind of spot the jackrabbits and stuff, because I love bunnies.
It's kind of
fruity, but like I love bunnies.
Well, that's cool. Wildlife,
yeah.
You know, it gives you something to do. I don't know, did it get boring, or I'm sure it got cold.
It got really, really boring, honestly.
Yeah.
What kind of armaments were up in the tower?
Not really any. I mean, like, I've got videos that you could see on my phone when you guys look through it. I mean, it was literally just sheet metal, about like that.
No, weapons.
Weapons? Just the personal weapons that we had?
The personal weapons?
Yep.
Which, so, like, so, like, when you were up there, you had an AR-15?
Yep.
Were there any larger caliber rifles?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
So it just,
I mean, like, if there was somebody up there that owned a higher caliber rifle, yeah, there would be. But
okay.
Not, like, not one, like, they mounted, like,
so you had 50 caliber or something?
No, no.
Okay.
No.
All right, so night vision, any kind of thermal imaging?
Negative. We had a, like, a Leopold spotting scope.
Mm-hmm.
But that's just kind of
okay.
One of those things that you'd obviously, you would see one in a tower.
Sure.
Obviously.
Yeah.
And a couple of binos.
Okay. And then, so obviously there was rotating shifts of patrols, two men in the tower.
One man at front gate, one man on back gate. Sorry, didn't want
to. Not to go. One man front gate, one man back gate. Who organized those?
It was kind of like a equal effort thing. Like, it was like, all right, who wants to be on tower? And then somebody goes up and writes a name up there on, underneath the tower, and then say, like, all right, who wants to be front gate? Somebody volunteers, like, God, all right.
So who kept the records, or who's saying, hey, we need to sign up for these?
Nobody personally kept the record. Like, said, I would, like, there would be, like, people like me, I'm not going to lie. I wrote down, like, tower, front gate, back gate, stuck it on a board. And then people would come by and be like, I haven't been on for a couple hours, I'll sign up.
So everyone pitched in?
Yeah.
Okay.
So was it kind of your...
It was like an integrity thing.
Okay. Kind of based on your background and experience in the military, what, did you kind of come up and say, this is kind of what we need to protect this place?
Not really, because, I mean, I like to keep to myself just because I didn't want to find myself in this position.
Mm-hmm.
Just so I was just like, I kind of kept to myself, and I noticed you had pictures over there, but I mean, that was just like me posing with friends, being like, yeah.
Oh, I'm just, we're going to ask you to identify some people on photos,
oh,
if you can.
Okay. Yeah.
But I just meant, like, so you said you wrote the paperwork for front gate, back gate, tower, and everyone else signed up.
Mm-hmm.
Is that accurate?
Yeah.
Was there anyone else that was dictating, like, what security we needed, or, you know, the group needed at the refuge?
That would probably be like Ammon Bundy and there's somebody else, I don't remember though.
But so Ammon Bundy would kind of dictate what would they need to secure this place?
Like, he was pretty much like, he was like our the big man on the total pool, like, yeah, he was kind of like the guy that would go out and be like, this is kind of what's going on, this is probably what we should do, just kind of try to even the odds a little bit, just to kind of, not even the odds, that's a horrible way to look at it.
Yeah, that's okay.
But
we get it, I think we understand it.
Yeah, like, kind of like to kind of ease the situation a little bit, because, I mean, we all really wanted just a peaceful outcome. Like, we didn't want, like, LaVoy, we didn't want nobody to get hurt.
Sure, okay. Can you tell me about LaVoy? You know, I mean, he was one of the faces in the media, and he seems like a good person to be.
Yeah, that's actually one guy that I actually had the honor to meet. Like, he was a really, really bright individual. Like, he really believed in the cause, what was going on. He was really constitutional. He always talked about his daughters, always. Like, you couldn't have a 5-minute conversation without him being like, oh, my daughter does that. Like, that's cool, LaVoy. Good for you, man.
Yeah.
He was a rancher. I think he said from Nevada, I want to say. I think he said he was from Nevada. But yeah, he was a really cool fellow.
That's it.
Okay.
Did you ask about Ritzheimer again? I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Yeah.
Ritzheimer?
Can you tell me about John Ritzheimer?
He was a Marine. He was really, really confident, really stern, definitely stern.
Yeah.
Like, cause whenever he put his part at the meeting in, he was, if you can always tell that person, like, that's like, this is what I think, and then everybody's like,
Okay.
But yeah, he was that individual. Like,
did he kind of run things from a security standpoint?
There might have been who else it was. Yeah, I guess you could say that. Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I wasn't there, so.
I mean, like he would help out every once in a while, but I mean, it wasn't really like he was running it out of. Because like I said, I kept my nose out of it just because I didn't want to find myself in this position. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
So I mean, like I was told to go to meetings, I went to a meeting. Like if I was told that I needed to sign up for the tower, I signed up for the tower.
Okay.
But like most of the time, it was like my God, I gotta sign up for tower again.
But you said like if I was told, who is telling you to do those things?
It would most likely be like John or. Scotty.
John Ritzheimer,
yeah.
Or Scotty? Okay.
Scotty was kind of like the, I guess you could call him like a like the barracks guard or whatever. He was that one guy in the barracks that if you're running down the hall too fast, he'd be like,
right.
So, yeah, he was that one guy.
Yeah.
You're just like, shut the hell up, old guy. Come on. Sorry.
So, besides John Ritzheimer, Scotty, and probably Am and Bundy that you said are kind of like running things, anybody else?
Ryan Payne, I guess you could say. I mean, because he was the one that kind of spoke up more at the meetings.
Okay.
I'm sorry, like you guys keep talking and it keeps kind of bringing more stuff
up. That's good.
I'm just
good.
Like, I'm trying to figure out who's talking more because I don't want you guys to see looking back at like page two be like, oh, he didn't know.
No, whatever comes to your mind, I appreciate it. You know, we're just kind of throwing out questions as they come, but you know, just about John Ritzheimer, were you familiar with some of the YouTube videos he had posted?
I saw one YouTube video that was like something about like the feds are coming, blah blah blah, and he was wearing like a full kit.
Okay.
With his rifle, and he's like, I don't want blood, who do you think really wants blah blah blah, and I'm like,
was that the one where he's in his truck or
he was just standing out by like the fire, I think.
Okay, I see. All right.
I couldn't really tell. It was dark and it was a video, so.
Do you know about his background, you know, before the refuse, like anything he did before that, or?
He was a Marine and I heard he did anti-Islam protests or something.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. what about, who is the guy? Buddha? Yeah.
I think I've talked to him maybe like 5 minutes.
Okay.
Like that's about it. I mean, like, all I know about him is he was one of Ammon's main bodyguards, and he was a false valor, excuse my language, but a douchebag.
Okay. You're saying, like, he said he was in the military, but never did?
Yeah, he said he was in the Marines, but evidently there's a bunch of people out there that kind of covered it up and was like, no, we have proof right here, he never served.
Was there anyone else like that, you know, that was proven to be incorrect, or they maybe stretched the truth a little bit about their service or something like that? Like,
I mean, I've heard of like the Oregonians and like John Ritzheimer and Ryan Payne and all of them did, but by what I know personally, that like what people have told me about them, like it's completely false.
They were both in the military.
Yeah,
they were both. Yeah.
Yeah.
About Jason Patrick.
Yes.
Did he have like a beard? And he was wearing a blazer a lot of time.
Yeah, and he had a Seahawks shirt on a lot too.
Can you tell me about him a little bit?
He was kind of like a correspondence guy, I guess.
Okay.
He was like the guy behind the phone and a lot, like.
Like coordinating, planning kind of thing? Or
yeah, I guess you could say that in a way. Like when LaVoy got shot, he was the first one to get the phone call, and he was on the phone with like Pete Santelli.
Okay.
He was on the phone with Pete Santelli a lot during that little time. There was like a couple of scares where we thought the FBI was gonna, you guys were gonna like roll in on the compound and ambush us, and he started calling around a lot and found out that it wasn't true.
Oh, I see. Okay. Did was that all he did, or did he ever go, you know, serve guard duty, go in the watchtower?
He was, he I guess he kind of went to the watchtower every once in a while.
Okay.
But, I mean, it's kind of the same thing with, like, John Ritzheimer, Ryan Payne, and all them. I mean, they'd go to, like, the front, the back gate, the tower, just to kind of be like, hey, what's up, guys? What do you guys need? Blah, blah, blah.
Okay.
You said you talked to Pete Santilli a lot. Tell us about Santilli.
Santilli, he was just a dude behind the camera with the cowboy hat. That's all I know.
Yeah. Did you talk to him at all? Or?
I mean, he's got me a few times, like on like one of his like live feeds, because I was just I'm only 26. Whenever I see a camera and get the chance to be famous, I kind of jump in the back of the camera. Right. I've seen a sandwich at the time, and he's live streaming, and I'm over there. I'm just like over his shoulder, like waving, and he's like, "Yeah, I'm over here at the refuge, blah blah." And I'm like, "Yep." Then I told my mom to look it up, and she's like, "Oh my God, really?" I'm like, "Yeah, I'm famous."
So with Pete, other journalists got onto the refuge, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Like other news people,
all the time.
And same with Pete Santilli. But when a lot of the other journalists left, did he kind of have more access, or was he more like
he was? I guess you could say he had more access. Because like he was there later than most of the other guys were, just because I guess I would call it more like a commitment.
Is it that, or did
I mean, I
did he did he participate in like some of the security stuff or anything?
No. I mean, like, I know the Idaho 3%, because when they went down to the FBI compound or something like that, I don't know what went on there, but when they went down to the FBI compound, the Idaho 3% gave him a patch or something like that, because he followed them down there and was like, oh, and filmed it. So,
okay. So did you ever see Pete Santilli with a weapon?
Negative.
What about Blaine Cooper?
Blaine Cooper?
Yeah. Can you tell us about Blaine at all? Did you get to know him a little bit?
He was really quiet for the most part. I mean, like, I tried to talk to him. Well, I guess I wouldn't say quiet. I mean, he did... You ever seen the movie Mary Poppins?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he liked to sing Mary Poppins a lot.
Oh, really?
A lot, yeah. he actually had quite a good voice, to be honest with you, but I mean, that's probably not what you guys are here wanting,
oh,
so
that's okay.
I'll shut up about that. But, let's see here. He was down there with his wife, Melissa?
Okay.
Let me get back to, you know, barricading, security shifts, and anything like that. You said everyone pretty much participated in all those,
mm-hmm.
like the securing of the refuge, and blockading. Were there blockades set up as well?
Towards the end, there was a big. I don't know what they call those. Big. Railroad ties. There was like a stack of like probably like four or five railroad ties high, by about four or five railroad ties deep,
mm-hmm.
stacked side by side, kind of like block a road just in case. Towards the back gate, there was, I don't know if you would call it a blockade, but there was a kind of like a narrow path from
mm-hmm.
front gate that was like the barriers that you see on like the freeway.
Yeah,
they had those stacked on top of each other.
Okay.
That's like kind of like a little, as like. Okay, so here's front gate.
Mm-hmm.
The barricade was right here and right here to let the traffic go through the middle.
Okay. Yeah. Kind of creating like a choke point or something, like a small area for vehicles.
Kinda, yeah. I mean, it was, we used it more to like hide behind, just in case.
Just in case what?
Because we were really scared that you guys were going to attack us, like, at a random.
Mm-hmm.
So we thought that if something was to happen, kind of something to duck down behind.
Okay. so blockades. So if let's say obviously, I assume some people probably showed up without guns or ammunition, like you didn't show up with ammunition. If you didn't show up with a gun, was there anyone there that would give weapons out?
Yes, but I don't remember who.
Okay.
I mean, like, it was just kind of like if somebody brought in an extra rifle or something, they'd hand it out, but I don't.
Did you see anybody give someone else a weapon?
Not personally, but I mean, I was like a buddy of mine, Joker J. Jason
Jason Blum. I think I've
Blogman
seen
it. Blogman or something?
Blogman.
Blogman.
Oh, Blum Green? Blum Green?
I don't, I'm not sure what his last name. We always called him Joker J.
Joker J.
Joker J.
Yeah, because he was just a funny.
Blomgren.
Funny guy.
That was it.
Blomgren, is that right?
Yeah, sounds familiar. Yeah.
So, what about him?
He was like, hey, so-and-so loaned me this, he had like a little 9mm pistol shooter, and then he came across like a bolt-action rifle. I don't remember who he said he gave it to him, but.
Someone loaned him a 9mm pistol,
mm-hmm.
and then a bolt-action rifle as well?
Yep. I don't remember who he said gave it to him or loaned it out to him, but.
Okay. Did you see anyone else issuing weapons?
Negative.
Okay.
Brandon Curtis. That's what I meant to ask you about.
Brandon Curtis.
Never heard of him.
Never heard of him. Okay.
Can I see a picture of him?
I was trying to find one here. Hold on a second. Let me see.
We'll do pictures here in a little bit. How about... Oh, Jason, so we were talking about Jason Patrick, right?
Yes.
Did you see him with, was he armed, firearm, carrying a firearm around?
He was seen every once in a while with an AR-15, but for the most part, he was carrying, like, some pistol, I'm not sure what caliber.
And a pistol. So he always, did he always have the pistol?
Yes.
And pistol, okay, always had pistol. And you saw him with the AR-15?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Same magazine setup, probably?
Yeah, probably.
Wait, 30-round mag, or?
I'd say so. I mean, it didn't look any bigger than mine.
Okay. How about Captain O, or O'Shaughnessy, I think is the last name? O'Shaughnessy.
O'Shaughnessy, yeah. Dave, I think he's a captain.
Captain O.
Did you hear anyone refer to anyone as Captain O?
I've heard of the name, not really ringing a bell of like face.
Something O'Shaughnessy.
I mean, there was a dude there wearing like a old revolutionary thing. I guess that guy could have been Captain O, maybe? Mm-hmm. But I doubt it.
Back to Santilli. How often would you see him?
Almost every day.
Almost every day?
Yeah, I mean, there was like a brief time where he was gone for like a week to 2 weeks or something like that.
Did he ever give other people orders on the rest?
Santilli?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
No, he was media. We were honestly kind of careful what he filmed. Not like not being like bad what we were doing, but like we were careful what he filmed. Like we didn't like him filming like our personal conversations about like, because I'm not, like, we kind of talked about some inappropriate stuff from home life,
mm-hmm.
if you know what I mean. Yeah. So I mean, it's, we didn't want him filming that on live stream and being like, that guy. No, we didn't like him filming that personal stuff. So
okay,
we kind of limited his stuff.
Would he attend some of the planning meetings?
I think I might have seen him there once.
At a planning meeting?
Like a planning meeting, like where like everybody, like
kind of the folks at the refuge, like, you know, where Ammon Bundy might be telling people what to do, or something where you're planning like security or what's going to happen at the refuge.
Negative. No, media wasn't allowed in there at all.
Okay.
Here's a picture of O'Shaughnessy right here. That guy.
I've seen him around.
Okay.
I never talked to him. I mean, I talked to him for like 2 minutes. He said he was a firefighter or something like that.
Okay. And what about, here's another, Shauna Cox.
Shauna Cox?
There.
she was always with like Ammon. She was always like with around like Ammon. And
okay.
Are you, wait, are you, you're showing booking photos from Multnomah County? Okay.
Yeah, just,
yeah.
That's fine. That's by the way.
So Shauna Cox, you said what about her?
She was always with like Ammon and them.
Always with Ammon and them? Okay. Okay. Anything else?
Dwayne Emmer? Remember him?
Dwayne? The horse dude?
Right there.
Yeah. The horse dude?
Yeah, yeah. With his
that's the guy that spent 25 hours in the tower.
Okay. What, do you remember his name?
It starts with a D, I thought.
Okay.
I don't know.
Let's see if I can get his name.
Okay.
But you remember Emmer, he was the horse guy?
Yeah, he rode a horse named Hellboy.
Hellboy. Named
Hellboy?
Yep.
Was he armed?
Yes, I think so.
Do you remember with what?
Like some old school looking revolver, like the one that the dude off of Walking Dead, the sheriff, looked like the one that he carried.
Okay.
Like the old like 357 or something.
That guy's name was Dylan, right?
Dylan, yep.
Dylan Wade Anderson was the guy you're saying spent about 25 hours.
Yeah.
Dylan Wade Anderson?
What'd he do for
We usually had like a bucket
of a rope.
Okay. That he would like put his stuff in, and then he would roll it up, and then most of the time it would be like water or something in that bucket. So you drink water, got an empty bottle.
Okay. Dump it. What was the tower like? And was it spacious? You know, was it more space than you would think?
No, it was pretty cramped.
Pretty cramped.
It was probably like from like right. From the back of his chair, right about there, to this wall, that way, and that was the tower.
Oh, okay. Chairs in there?
There was a little camping chair that broke when...
Really?
Yeah, I sat on it and broke. So I was like, ah!
Okay.
So. Now, you had mentioned earlier about, you know, you guys were fearful that the FBI would come in, and you guys would, you know, you put all these armaments because of that fear. And barricades and things like that. If a federal employee tried to get on the refuge, what would you guys have done?
It's kind of hard to tell. Like me personally,
I would say the group, because I mean, like knowing how you guys set up security and everything. If you know if some Fed tried to get on the property, I mean. Would you guys stop? Nope, you're not, you know.
I mean, as long as they weren't, like, intimidating us, like, trying, like, you know, like, being like, let me on kind of thing, like, we'd be like, all right, it's open property.
So, you don't think anybody... I don't know how to say that.
Anybody would be like, no, and then point their gun at somebody?
Yeah, I mean, like, everybody was armed. You had rifles out, barricades, and all that.
I mean, I would hope nobody would point a gun at somebody. Sure. Unless, like, you know, that's just me, though. Like, I would hope that nobody would point a gun at somebody. I mean, if somebody was pointing a gun at me and I felt like I was in imminent danger, yes, of course. I mean, yeah. I'd be like, whoa. But, I mean, in that case, then...
But then, like, if the feds came, like you said, like, what you were all fearful of, you guys would have gotten, I mean, I assume, barricaded positions, and there would, a standoff, would that have probably been the best case scenario?
Well, I mean, what everybody's calling it is already a standoff.
Okay.
So, I mean, like, I guess like it would be considered more of like a weight off, more or less, like
a weight off.
Guns pointing at each other, being like, "No, you put yours down. No, you put yours down."
Okay,
but I mean, I would hope nobody would point a gun at because that's not what we were out there for.
Go ahead. Just formulate that thought here.
Okay. Back to the kind of organizational structure of the group. You said kind of. Ammon Bundy was kind of calling the shots.
Yeah, and then I guess like you could also say like the other fellow said that name to her too.
Who?
Like it was kind of like a rank structure. It was like Ammon. There was Ammon Bundy.
So it, just who's at the top?
Ammon Bundy.
Okay, Ammon Bundy at the top. Who? What would be like the second level in command?
I don't know if you would consider him second level in command, but it was his personal bodyguard. It's Buddha.
Buddha. Okay, kind of up there.
Polar Bear, I guess you want to call him that. He went by a bunch of different names. He went by like Raging Unicorn at one point in time.
What's his name?
Cavalier.
O'Brien Cavalier. Did you know him by that name, or
I just knew him by Buddha.
Buddha. Describe Buddha. What does he look like?
He was kind of a meteor-looking guy. Had tattoos everywhere.
Okay.
How about on his face? Yeah.
Face?
I think so.
Okay. All right. So Ammon Bundy and Buddha, and then what? Just give me your kind of layout of what you thought the structure was.
So it would be like Ammon and Ryan. Ryan Bundy.
Okay.
Ammon and Ryan. Then there would be like there would be like two branches off of that. It would be like Ryan Payne and John Ritzheimer. Not in that order. I mean, it's
sure. Like two different branches, Ryan Payne and then Ritzheimer, or Ryan Payne and Ritzheimer on one branch?
Like, they're like equals.
Okay, Ryan Payne and John Ritzheimer.
Mm-hmm. After that, it was basically just a match free-for-all. I mean, like, there would be, like, I guess you could say, like, in the middle of them, there would be, like, Jason Patrick, if you want to consider him one, but I mean...
Would he be equal to Ryan Payne and John Ritzheimer?
He would be, like, probably right below, honestly.
But like, up in that top tier level?
He'd probably be, like, right below.
Okay, so Jason Patrick. Mm-hmm. So he can kind of call the shots if he needed to. Like, he could order people around to do things.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
Okay. Did he ever order you to do anything?
Not that I can remember right now. I've got off the top of my head now.
All right. Anyone else, like the next tier or kind of leaders?
After them, I would say it's more like a free-for-all, because like they were the guys that basically, like,
okay,
during the meeting, they would do the talking, and then we would all kind of discuss it as a group, and then figure out what's the best combination of structure,
okay,
I guess, if you will.
What about any of the Idaho guys? Like, I think this guy's from Idaho. You know any of those people? Yeah,
negative.
The 3%er people.
Negative.
Okay. I don't know anything about them, other than like what I've read in the paper. So
I knew they were a bunch of freaking gung-ho people that showed up one day with guns and was like, let's go talk to the FBI. And I'm like, I don't know if that's a good idea.
So did they show up at the refuge first?
Mm-hmm. They showed up at the refuge first.
And what happened? Did they come on and
they showed up? They showed up, and like I think it was like an 18-car convoy. They showed up, and we were all like, because we thought it was like the FBI that was rolling up on us, so we were all like freaking out, being like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And me, I grabbed my medic bag and ran up to the front gate, and there was just a bunch of guys out there that were like, oh, we're from Idaho, blah, 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 we want down now. And we're like, you guys don't fit the persona that we're wanting down there right now. So we're going to keep you up here just for our safety. And so they were up there for...
When you say up there, you mean up near
up
the front gate.
Yeah,
okay.
The front gate.
Okay.
They were up there for, I don't want to throw a number out there, but because like, they're probably up there for a little bit longer than I'm aware of. But
They were
up the front gate. They were probably up the front gate for a little longer than I'm aware of. So I don't want to shoot a timeout there.
Well, that's okay.
Completely wrong.
That's okay.
But they were up there for a while and basically stealing the media and being like, oh, we got guns, blah, 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 and like completely changing the entire image that we were trying to create, being like, because when media was down there, we didn't carry nothing. We dressed in, like, you would see me down there like this. And when media wasn't there, that's when we, you know, dressed up, because that was when we were more like that. But
you were more like what?
Like, more like fearful that something's going to happen, because it was nighttime. It was kind of...
So you gave a one appearance for the media and kind of, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but the refuge kind of seemed like open and nice place. And then when the media left, you guys kind of tacked, geared up.
Well, I mean, it was a nice place, honestly. Like, I mean,
maybe that's the wrong word choice.
It was a really nice place to be at. But,
you acted different with media there than you did without.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I guess you could kind of say that, because like it was just based off of fear. Like,
okay,
we would have, say, like media come down, because I mean, when the media is there, I don't believe nobody was really gonna have the balls or the courage to attack while the media is there, just to have everybody film it.
Mm-hmm.
But like when the media left for the night, that's when we were like, okay, we don't have anybody here with a camera, like, filming for live stream or nothing like that, so we geared up and was like, okay, well, if this is what's going to happen, then this is the time we're most likely going to do it. So that's when we tacked up.
Was there ever anyone in the media that seemed kind of pushy, or, you know, that wasn't as welcome as some other members of the media? You know, like, maybe they had an angle or a slant or something like that.
The New York Times, they were really, really, they weren't allowed down there very much, just
really?
Because, like, they were slandering us, like, a lot. Kind of twisting people's words
mm-hmm.
around. But ever since the Sharp family got down there, they were, the News Times lady, the New York Times, I mean, the lady working for them, followed them around and was like, okay, maybe I was wrong about you guys, blah, blah, blah.
Okay. And you said the Sharp family?
Mm-hmm.
What are the, I'm sorry, the Sharps? What are their names?
All I knew was Victoria and Emelina.
Okay. They, and you're talking about following them around on the refuge, or in town or something, or?
Well, not really in town, but like, it was just like, they were, when they were at the refuge, the News Times lady would go around kind of documenting what they were doing.
Okay.
So they were media?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the Sharps weren't media. The Sharps were like our choir, basically, to kind of keep our morale and our spirits lifted.
Okay.
Because they were really, really Christian, and they would sing nothing but like Christian music, and they were beautiful voices.
Really? Okay.
Beautiful voices. But
okay.
Yeah.
BJ Soper, you ever heard that name?
Not ringing a bell.
Okay. Are you familiar at all with the PPN, the Pacific Patriots Network? Like, you're, okay. I'm just curious. Because I know that they've been pretty active in the whole thing too, you know, trying to help mediate and things like that. So I don't know if you're familiar. I think he's the head of the PPN, or he's one of the heads of them. I'm not sure. Just trying to think of what about the four people remaining? Have you heard about them? The four?
David Fry and
them. Anderson and his wife, and I think Banta. I think that was another guy.
Yeah. Banta?
Yes. Yeah.
Jeff Banta.
Jeff Banta. I mean, do you know any of them? Did you hear about what
I thought I was the only Jeff there. Honestly.
Okay.
I mean, so Fry, Banta,
I mean, anybody,
and I think Anderson. You don't know any of them?
I do know, like, Sean Anderson and his wife, Barbara, what's her name was? And David Fry, he was, like, kind of like our media inside guy, kind of getting the truth of what was going on inside the compound out there. Like,
when you say out there, out to the media or out to the...
Out to, like, the globe.
Oh, I see.
Not to America.
Different ways of, on the internet, or
mm-hmm.
Okay.
Social media, that kind of tactic.
Did you see them armed?
At times, yes.
Which ones?
David Fry was for, like, I never saw him carry a rifle or anything like that until, like, probably like right before I left, he started carrying a rifle around. Right before I left, meaning like probably like a day or two before I left, he started carrying the rifle.
Okay.
Sean and his wife, like, Yeah, they were carrying it.
Sean and Barbara?
Barbara, I think her name was. Yeah.
Sean Anderson and his wife. You saw both of them carrying?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of weapons?
Long rifles. I don't want to say any names of what they were because I mean, I'm probably way off of what they were.
Yeah.
Because I can't really remember.
Would you say their frames of mind were, you know?
They were really peaceful minded. Like, they wanted it all to end peacefully. Like, they were there to basically see it to the end, and they wanted it to end peacefully. I think that's probably why they were there for as long as they were, because they wanted to see it end peacefully.
Right.
They wanted basically peaceful resolution. That's all I can really say about them.
What about Fry?
Fry, he was a really, really nerdy guy. I mean, he was skinny, long hair, glasses.
Would you say he's of sound mind? You know, like, is he all together there? What do you think?
He said that kind of, I guess you could kind of say he was like a straight-minded, like, meaning like a, I don't know how to explain it. He was a, I don't know where I'm going with that one, honestly.
Okay.
But like he was pretty straight-minded.
Okay.
Do you need a break or anything, or?
I don't have any cigarettes. They took them from
me. Okay. Water, anything like that? Do you need anything?
No.
Are you okay to go a little bit longer for an interview?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Would you mind me looking at my phone and getting the number off of it for my fiance after this is all over, so I can get my baby down here?
Yeah, we're gonna get it for you.
Yeah.
Okay.
That your buddy said you gotta bring her down. So. To say goodnight.
So when we're done, if he's not here, then yeah, we'll get the number.
Yeah.
But
I just want to make sure you're okay.
I want to get this as close to done as possible.
Okay.
They kind of hopefully cut your time short.
If you ever need to use your bathroom,
just say
if
so.
You want water, just let us know.
Okay. Thank you.
And then Banta, I'm in town. About Banta, can you tell us about him at all?
Banta, I've never even heard of him. I thought, like I said, I thought it was going to be Jeff there.
Okay.
Do you guys have a picture of him?
Yeah, I can try to find one here for you. I mean, have you kept up at all with the, you know?
After I left, I kind of just like, nope.
Okay.
So, I mean, like
even yesterday, did you hear?
I did hear, actually, because, I mean, my phone was off and dead for a couple of days. So, I mean, I just logged back onto Facebook today and then found out about what was going on and blah, blah.
Okay. You want... Mind if I start going through some of these pictures?
Yeah, sure.
We're not sure, and we just want to go through some of these, and if you can identify anybody.
Mm-hmm.
So this picture, obviously, do you know who's in there?
Yes, that is Eric Fiores.
Can you write their names? You could do it in the white so we could see. So the one on the left is Eric who?
Eric Flores.
Flores? Okay.
Damn, I don't know his last name.
Okay, that's fine.
And then me.
So it's Eric Flores. Who's in the middle?
That's...
Who?
Left, middle, right.
Okay, so Eric Flores, in the middle is, you put Daryl?
Yes.
Who's Daryl?
Daryl, I don't know his last name. Daryl.
Okay. And then you're on the right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and where is that photo taken?
That's in the main area, common area. Like over here, like right here would be like the couch. Over here would be the windows and the couch.
Common area of the refuge?
The
bunkhouse. Okay. So, let me write that. So, this is bunkhouse at the refuge.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Eric Flores, Daryl, and yourself in front of an American flag.
Yep.
And what's the hand
gesture.
That's the 3%.
3%?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then this is Danta.
Never even seen him there.
Okay, no problem.
Okay. So that okay, the bunkhouse. Who's in this picture?
That I just said his name. What's the first couple guys that I said I went down to with? Did you write those guys down?
Yeah.
I just
Jeremy.
John Jonah, but no, this is the other one. Tom Wagner.
Tom Wagner.
Yeah, you said Tom Wagner and Jeremy Evans Smith was the guys you went down with.
So that's Tom Wagner. This guy?
Yes.
Okay. So I'm just gonna circle here. And that is that you?
Yes, that's
okay. Me. And what are you carrying there?
That's my pistol that I was carrying when you guys.
Okay. What caliber pistol is it?
It's just a 9mm.
9mm?
Yeah.
Okay. Just save me. That's your 9 and that's also at the refuge?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that's actually in the we were cleaning this area up. That's what that picture was taken. That's
Where in the refuge is that?
That's probably like if you were to like go past like the HQ building.
Mm-hmm.
That was like 3. You know, can I draw your map real quick?
Sure.
Okay. I'm just trying to help you guys out as much as possible to make
great.
My case a little bit better. All right. So this right here to. Right here would be HQ. It would be Firehouse 1. Be 3, like this right here was this one.
That's where it was.
This one.
Okay. And these are different. What are these?
These are like big storage units.
Storage.
Like big warehouse, basically.
Okay. Top photo, is that you?
That's me.
Just put you in. Is that your rifle?
Yes.
Okay. AR-15?
Yes.
Where is that located?
That's just at the base of the tower. Front gate, it's like right over here. That's the tower right there in the background.
Can you circle it? Say tower.
Tower, and then...
Okay, and then how about this one?
That's me and Joker J. Jason Blomgren.
Can you just write the names?
Jeremy Blomgren. I don't remember his name.
You can put his what you think his name is and his nickname. Was that photo taken at the refuge as well?
Yes, it was.
Okay.
And then the front door is like right here.
Front door of?
Front door of the
of the refuge,
or not the refuge, the bunkhouse. That's the front door.
So that's Joker J, right?
Yes.
Okay, and that's you.
Yep.
Just write me.
And is that in the photo? Is that your assault rifle that you left?
Yes, that's mine. That's the one that I was telling you about, the bolt action that he borrowed.
So okay. He someone gave him that gun.
Yeah.
While he was there, and you don't remember who that was.
I don't remember.
Okay. And that one,
that's me.
That's you?
Just right me.
Front gate's right there.
Okay.
Did you ever see in the news I read about artifacts that were there?
I've never seen.
Did you ever see them? Never. Okay. Do you know what I'm talking about, though?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've heard stories about artifacts being found there, but I've never personally seen any.
Okay.
Those are the same two pictures, right?
Yes.
Black
yes, sir.
What... and that's you. What's the flag in the background there?
That's the American flag. It's kind of something we all signed it, like basically like who all was there.
Okay. Who brought the flag? Do you remember?
I don't know.
Okay.
All I know is it was on a table and they were like, hey, we want this signed. We were all at the end of the time. At the end of the thing, we were going to give it to Ammon Bundy, but...
You guys were going to... Who's you?
Like all of us, like everybody that was there.
Was going to sign it and give it to Ammon Bundy. Okay.
Do you know if anyone there ever spoke with any FBI negotiators? Anything like that? Did you ever hear about anyone speaking with Ammon Bundy or anyone else there?
I've heard of, like, excuse me, Ammon talking to people,
said. It's okay if he did. I'm just curious if he did.
Yeah, he would come down and basically give us like a brief, like what was said, how it went, kind of, but nothing like to the point. Like, this is what I said. This is exactly what,
right,
what
right.
he said. But it was like, okay. This is what I brought up. This is what they thought of it.
Was there ever any talk of guessing what kind of equipment, you know, was being used? The FBI and all the things it has at its disposal, you know, things it's using or can use. Like, does mm-hmm. anyone saying, oh, they might be using this, they might be using that? I'm just curious. I saw a YouTube video of Santilli mm-hmm. accusing one of the guards.
Oh, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Of like mind control.
No,
he's like, I know you guys are using mind control.
Oh, I didn't see that one, but like, you did bring out something. There was a guy there during when, I don't remember the gentleman's name, but he came down from, I think, New Mexico. He was signing his thing to end the contract for the BLM or whatever. And there was a guy down there that was a protester, I guess mm-hmm. you'd call him. Mm-hmm. He was holding a sign that said, stop the Bundy land grab or something. And Santelli was like, wait a second, I know you. So he brought up the picture of him dressed as like, in his FBI stuff, but I don't.
Right.
I didn't really see any.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about.
Yeah,
I heard about that too.
I didn't really see any too much resemblance, but I guess I kind of did because he had the same hat and like the same
yeah.
color coat on.
Yeah. That was actually a protester. That wasn't the same person. They dressed alike. They looked alike, but it wasn't the same guy. I heard about that too, yeah. What we're doing now is we're just listing the stuff that we're going to go ahead and take as evidence. Some of it we may end up giving right back. We may not need. It's up to the U.S. Attorney's Office whether or not they want to keep it or not. Okay. And if we give it back, it'll either be given back to whoever is assigned as your attorney, or we can give it back to someone if you want to designate someone right now as to be the person that you would want to come or to take that stuff from us. We can bring it to them, you know, however you want to do it. But
okay.
This is just another administrative form we have. It's a receipt, basically, and you'll keep a copy, and we'll keep a copy. But eventually, you're going to get yourself back.
No, I completely understand. You guys are doing what you guys are doing.
No, I just want to make sure you understand that, what we're doing here.
I'm just trying to show you guys. I was literally down there for a peaceful protest.
I appreciate that. I understand.
I didn't ask you this, but on these photographs, where do you know who took the photo?
No.
Okay.
Not that one.
Did you post this or no?
Scotty, I think, took this picture. Cameraman.
Scotty the cameraman?
Yep.
You read that? You say you believe Scotty the cameraman took that? Picture?
That was one of the news reporters.
Okay. You know for a fact, or?
Yes, because I remember that was right after I got down with guard duty, and they basically, right after the gentleman, Kenneth Waldro, or something like that, got arrested for driving the federal truck.
Okay.
Right after he did, and then they snapped this picture. Being like, oh, so.
Okay, so right after that guy was arrested, they
took a picture of
this. Do you know who took that photo?
No.
How about this one?
That was me.
You took that photo?
Yeah, that was
just right.
Selfie.
I took this selfie at the refuge.
Selfie.
All right.
you know Reddy Cox?
Picture?
Yeah. That's your selfie.
Yep.
Who took that one again?
I don't remember.
You don't remember that one? And then, did you say who took that one?
Yeah,
Yeah, you believe Scotty. Scotty took that, and then you know who took that one.
That was actually a guy from a Paris newspaper company.
Paris?
Yeah, like that's what I was thinking.
Like Paris, France?
Yeah, he was like a Paris newspaper company.
Okay.
He was down there taking pictures.
That's right. I think Paris newspaper company, Paris, France newspaper company. You don't know his name though, do you?
Not so well known.
Going to, do you have anything else?
I'm trying to get a photo of Cox. I'm going to try to find his name.
Is there anything else that might help or other people we haven't talked about that maybe were down there or that played a significant role in this?
I guess Will Coleman.
Will Coleman?
Yeah.
Okay.
Travis Cox.
Travis Cox. Name sounds familiar, but I don't remember your face.
Me too, looking at a picture.
So Will Coleman, what was his role? Or
he was there for like maybe a week, if that. Mm-hmm. No, it was probably like 5 days, but almost a week. He was basically just down there to see how things were going, and he planned on coming back with people, but he never showed up. Basically had, you know, his life to take after and all that kind of stuff.
Okay.
But he's not going to know I told you that, is he?
I will not. Do not plan on talking to Will Coleman. I don't even know who he is.
Yeah, I've never heard of him. So.
Anyone else in more of a leadership type role, kind of running things? Is there anyone that was there that kind of worried you, that you thought was going to be violent? Maybe, you know, someone that might take matters in their own hand. I don't know.
We all kind of kept an even mindset that, like, because we all, like, had families. And, mm-hmm. Well, most of us had families to get back to. And we all believed that, you know, if everybody goes home alive, that's a successful mission. Mm-hmm. So we didn't want to engage. And everybody knew that, so like it was basically don't fire from me. But then there was me that was just like, I don't care what y'all say, I'm not shooting at nobody.
If law enforcement did fire, do you think a lot of these people would have fired upon law enforcement?
I would think so, yeah, just to defend themselves.
Yeah.
But me, like, I fought for America, like, not, like, I wouldn't say that, because, like, but, I joined to serve for America, mm-hmm. And I'm not going to shoot the people that I spent 3.5 years protecting, so, that was just kind of the way I thought about it, but.
Mm-hmm. Okay, did you guys have to keep anyone else in check, though? Like, hey, you know, someone...
We've had to calm down a few people. Like, the Scotty cameraman, he would get really rambunctious and be like, let's do this. And we're like, dude, calm down. What are you doing?
So getting more aggressive? Or?
Yeah, when Kenneth got attacked, like I told you about, or got, not attacked, sorry, arrested.
Kenneth, the guy with Kenneth. The with the government vehicle?
Yeah.
Okay. When Kenneth got arrested.
When he got arrested, he was like, we need to get down there now. We need to get him out of there. We're going to bust through the blockade, get him out now. And I'm like, I'm not, no. You could take yourself there, but I'm not going with you.
So, kind of Scotty, the cameraman, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but wanted to mount like an offensive operation?
Not more offensive, but more like an extraction.
Okay.
But go after law enforcement to get him out, or
not go after law enforcement. He like the way he was talking about it is basically like he was gonna drive past, roll down the window, have me jump in, and then
okay, just kind of like a snatch and grab him back.
Pretty much. Yeah. I hope I'm being helpful to you guys. I mean,
yeah, we're trying to get
your LSD. Appreciate it.
Trying to get a better idea of what how things went down. Anything else you can think of?
Mm-hmm. You guys are basically running the well dry right about now.
No.
If I get that photo, I'll show it to you.
Okay.
So I'm going to need to go and get the items about items that were taken from the vehicle, like he said, that that we think we need. And we'll have you sign this form. Is there anything else?
Oh, yeah.
Travis Cox.
Travis Cox, okay.
Yeah. He had his girlfriend down there once. I don't remember her name. But
Travis Cox.
It was like Emily.
Had a girlfriend down there.
Do you know where it might be right now?
I never really talked to him about that kind of stuff.
Did he ever say where he was from or anything like that?
I think he said, like, Redmond?
Redmond?
Say?
So Travis Cox said he was from Redmond?
I think so. It's like Redmond.
Did he look like that, or did he have the beard when he was...
He had the beard.
He had the beard, okay.
But you knew him?
Yes.
And he was down at the refuge?
Mm-hmm. Was he armed too? Did he?
Yes.
He was, okay. Did he have a... What kind of weapon did he have?
It's an AR.
AR, yeah. Okay. Was he in the military?
No, I think he said he was wanting to join.
Really? Okay.
But something happened with like an ASVAB or something.
Okay.
He wasn't able to join.
He said his girlfriend was down there with him. Mm-hmm. What was the girlfriend's name?
Emily.
Emily. Was she armed?
Negative. Not that I was aware. She was teeny. I think she would fall down or she even fired an AR.
Okay. Well, I mean, how serious were they? Were they engaged? You know, are they, you know, newly, or
they were there for the long haul. I mean
were they engaged to be married, or, you know,
they were
serious?
They were serious.
Okay. You remember, did he have a car? Did he drive any vehicles when he was out there? Did he show up in a car or leave in a car?
I don't remember, honestly. Okay. I mean, he could have driven, no, his girlfriend had a car. I don't remember what kind of car it was, but his girlfriend did have a car.
Okay.
Did they travel down there in the girlfriend's car?
I'm not sure.
Did you see anybody operating any of the vehicles, the government vehicles down there?
The front gate, that was a government vehicle, but I mean, that was just...
Ford and back.
Yeah.
Who operated that?
The front gate person.
Whoever was there.
Yeah. So I'm not going to lie. I mean, I operated it like once or twice.
When you were there, you operated a blockade vehicle. Is that what it was used for? Or?
It wasn't really a blockade vehicle. It was basically more like, kind of like, you know, like the regular gate.
A gate arm, yeah.
Yeah.
But you guys kind of blocked the entrance.
Yeah, it was just to keep the peace, basically, is what we used, just because I... we've had people come in and be like, wow, and I'm like, sit there and rev their engines at us like they were gonna run down. So that's when we decided we were gonna park a truck up there to make sure that nobody got down there to cause havoc, start shooting rounds, and then next thing we know, we're getting blamed for it. So
those people that came up, who were those people?
They were just really angry protesters. Like,
so you would keep those people out?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, like, we'd allow protesters in at some points in time, like the celebration that was going on with mm-hmm. the Sharp family and the dude sound the BLM concert, BLM free thing. They were down there, and they were allowed down there, and they came up to the bunkhouse a few times and stood there and was like, "Oh, you guys are wrong, blah blah."
No, okay.
But yeah. Other than that, they never really came down. They always usually stayed up front where all the media.
because of that, you guys had that, and just in case, so they couldn't get in.
Yeah, I mean, like, if, like I said, like, you guys showed up dressed like you are right now, saying, hey, we want to talk to Ammon, we'd like, we completely open it up and be like, okay, by all means.
But if, you know, we put, you know, Kevin here in tactical gear with FBI on it.
I mean, we'd be a little bit worried about it, but, I mean, it is public property, so, I mean, we didn't have the authority to keep anybody out. So, I mean, we'd be like, all right, well, college? I mean, that's just me, though. Like, I don't know about anybody else, but, I mean, like, if, like, somebody with authority came up to me and was like, I want to go down there, I'd be like, all right, well, let me get in the truck, back it up real quick.
So, okay. Is there a picture of a guy dressed up like George Washington or something like that?
Yeah.
Yeah, was he, was that just posing for photos or?
No, he was like some general guy that I think actually, probably, these are from Facebook, they're probably on this side right here. But he was he was like a real general or something like that. It served on like Desert Storm.
Oh, really?
I want to say. And then he earned like a Bronze Star and he gave it to Ammon Bundy.
Wow.
Yeah.
You don't remember his name?
I never really asked for it. I mean, I've got a video of me spinning a circle around and then, like, it was like spinning a circle, being like showing everybody. And then I stopped on him and I was like, wait a second. And I pointed at him because I was filming myself. And I was like, you'll see the video once you guys look through it.
What about the med tent? I heard a med tent was set
up. Oh, the Oath Keeper guys?
Yeah, did they set that up?
Yes.
Did you help out with that?
Yes, I mean, as being the medic, yes.
Okay.
I do not remember any of the guys' names. I apologize.
Oh, it's okay. I mean, what was it for? Just preparation for any...
It was more or less like it was like a precautionary measure. Like they were there just like I was. Like somebody fell off the tower. They want somebody to be there and be able to get, because my job basically, when I talked to them, I was to get them stabilized from the refuge to their point, and then from their that point, they would get them stabilized even more, and then transport them in a vehicle that was more equipped than mine was to the hospital. But they were there for, like, somebody had, like, an ND, a negligent discharge.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody had like one of those, somebody fell off the tower, somebody slipped on ice, cracked their head open, that kind of stuff.
Are you familiar with the Clive and Bundy Ranch issue that happened in 2014 in Vegas? Did you go out there and see what happened?
That one was like, that was way past me. Me, I would have, like I said,
okay.
I like to take part in peaceful protests, not like, if, like, yeah.
I was just curious. It was a couple of years ago, but I was just curious about that.
You were talking about and like negligent discharges and stuff, and gun, you know, so related to gunshot wounds. When you guys set up these things, were they set up to care for trauma victims of gunshot wounds?
Yep, we had like IV saline solutions and all that kind of stuff there, like with IV needles. Oxygen tanks.
Okay.
Like, you know, just the regular necessities as if you would see like in a regular hospital room.
Okay. So you guys were set up for, I mean, trauma casualties.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay.
Basically like a little MASH unit.
Okay. I'm gonna step out and go to the locker, Kevin.
Sure.
I'm gonna ask an officer to come and sit in. I'm just gonna get this stuff so I can make a list, and then we can get you to sign for it.
You want me to go get it, or you want to get it? It's fine.
Nah,
all right, no problem.
It's fine.
All right.
But yeah, if you think of anything else,
sure.
I'll have the officer come in here.
One question: you guys are like partners, like crime stopping partners, like CSI yeah. kind of stuff.
We work together, yeah. We're partners.
That's freaking cool.
How long were you there?
It's 3.5 years. Yeah.
Did you deploy at all? Did you?
Negative.
No? Okay.
I can get one of you just to have a seat. In there. Well, let's do it
You want to do it right now?
Yes.
All right. So we're going to, I told you that they record these rooms, and they have